Welcome to worship for Sunday, May 9th. I'm Pastor Mariah Furness-Tolgard, and on behalf of Hamline Church United Methodist, thank you for joining us for worship. What a joy it is to get together for worship this spring day as we watch signs of God's creation emerging all around us. We continue this week in our I See You series, looking at how it is we are called to both deeply listen and to act for the love of our neighbors and stand against injustice in the world. I invite you to follow along in our worship service as is printed in the worship guide that is available on the live stream page of our website or in the comments section if you're watching on Facebook or YouTube. There you'll find the order of our service for today and the names of all the participants and the musical pieces, as well as links to more information about Hamline Church and our upcoming weekly events. We also want to welcome anyone who is watching live with us on Facebook or YouTube to join us in the comments section to say good morning and peace be with you and to share any prayer requests that you may have. We ask that everybody who tunes in at any time take just a moment to fill out the connection card. The link is on the live stream page or in the comments section, and to let us know that you are worshiping with us. If you are new to Hamline Church, thank you for joining us. We are so glad that you are here and hope that you will fill out the connection card and ask any questions you may have about the church or sign up to receive our weekly emails there as well. This day, we also, of course, celebrate and observe Mother's Day, so happy Mother's Day to all of those who are celebrating today, and we will have a special tribute coming up later in our worship. So friends, we enter worship this week, as we do every week, with coming together for a time of prayer. Please join me as we pray. Gracious God, break our reliance on the things of comfort. Break our desire to turn the things of tradition that exclude and push away. Help us to see every piece of what we do as full of possibility. Help us work towards inclusion and justice where all means all. Amen.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning to thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever
blessings all mine with 10,000.
and beside. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see.
Thank you so much, David and Eileen. That was beautiful. It's such a wonderful hymn. Thank you. Friends, it is a time in our service when we lift up ourselves in prayer to God. So I ask you to close your eyes, get comfortable wherever you are, and breathe with me. Holy One, we gather in your presence to give you thanks and to celebrate the gift of your love, a love that supports, nurtures, and challenges us in ways that strengthen and transform us. God, we offer you praise and thanksgiving for your unfailing presence in our lives and all the blessings that you generously offer to us. And today, as we celebrate Mother's Day, we give thanks for all those mothering figures the world over. We also acknowledge that this is a day could be greatest joy or your deepest heartache, or somewhere in between. And so we offer to God our pain, our suffering. We give thanks for all those who have nurtured and cared for us, remembering especially birth mothers, adoptive mothers, surrogate mothers, aunts, grandmothers, teachers, neighbors, and all those mothering figures who have shared their faith with us. We pray, compassionate God, for those mothering figures who have been hurt, disillusioned, or disappointed in their role as mother. We pray for those who have been denied a longed-for chance at motherhood, and for those whose years of mothering have been cut short by the loss of a child. We lift up before you, O God, the members of our human family around the world. For those who are afflicted or suffering at this time, for those who need healing, for those who require bread or shelter, for those who live in violent homes and communities, for those who are grieving, and for those whose needs are known to only you, God. We name what is in our hearts. We name those on our prayer lists. And we remember that you, God, are our mother and father of us all. We ask you to touch us with your healing peace and gentle embrace that we may walk in your ways, bringing dignity, justice, and peace to all corners of this world. We offer this and we pray this in the name of your Son, Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our Father and our Mother, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy community come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from ego, for yours is the community and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen and amen. And as we have said, there are many ways that we celebrate mothering figures in our lives and in this life of Hamline Church. And you all have sent in some of those photos too, to honor those and to remember those and to remember that feeling that we have for those folks. So at this time, we would like to take the opportunity for you to see that and to remember those folks in your community and in this community that we hold so dear. So enjoy this mom-tage brought to you by Betsy, the members of this community, and Eileen.
Hi, this is Tommy Voschel, and this is a reading from Scriptures number 27, 1 through 11. Then the daughters of Zelophehad came forward. Zelophehad was son of Hepher, son of Gilead, son of Machir, son of Manasseh, son of Joseph, a member of the Manassite clans. The names of his daughters were Mahla, Noah, Hagla, Milcah, and Tirzah. They stood before Moses. Eleazar the priest, the leaders, and all the congregation at the entrance of the tent of meeting. And they said, "Our father died in the wilderness. He was not among the company of those who gathered themselves together against the Lord in the company of Korah, but died for his own sin, and he had no sons. Why should the name of our father be taken away from his clan because he had no son? Give to us a possession among our father's brothers." Moses brought their case before the Lord. And the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, "The daughters of Zelophehad are right. What they are saying, you shall indeed let them possess an inheritance among their father's brothers, and pass the inheritance of their father onto them. You shall also say to Israelites, if a man dies and has no son, then you shall pass his inheritance onto his daughter. If he has no daughter, then you shall give his inheritance to his brothers. If he has no brothers, and you shall give his inheritance to his father's brothers. And if his father's brother has no brothers, then you shall give his inheritance to the nearest kinsman of his clan. And he shall possess it. And it shall for the Israelites a statute and ordinance as the Lord commanded Moses." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Last week, we started our series, I See You, with the story of Jesus and Bartimaeus. And we talked about the importance of truly listening to people, especially listening to the voices of those on the margins. Yet our faith also calls us to act in the face of injustice and inequity that drives people to the margins of society. Now, for many of us, the instinct to stand up to some kind of injustice or inequity starts at a very young age. We usually start by noticing the injustices that we perceive that we ourselves are experiencing. If you grew up with siblings or close cousins or friends, you know what I'm talking about. It often shows up along the lines of, "No fair, she gets a bigger piece of cake than I do." In my house, this sort of injustice is often called out before everyone even has the piece of cake in front of them. As children, justice is equated with fairness, and it is a seemingly very black and white issue between fair and not fair. Gradually, as we age, our sense of justice and equity expands to others, and hopefully connects with our feelings of compassion and empathy for one another. Now, as many of you know, there are a lot of lawyers in my family, including both of my parents. So I think I was particularly attuned to fairness and injustice from an early age. I'm sure I did my fair share of complaining about sizes of cake slices. But what stands out more clearly for me is that since I was little, I have had a visceral reaction whenever I firsthand see something unfair or unjust happening to someone. There's a swelling up in my chest and shoulders, a defensiveness rising up, and I just can't keep my mouth shut. Shocking, I know. Now, I will tell you that this led to many unpleasant interaction on the school bus as I tried to defend kids who were being picked on or tried to call out bullies. Another time I remember I took it upon myself to defend a classmate who I felt was being unfairly punished by the lunch aide. For what offense, I have no idea. But the end result was that I found myself with my name on the board with two checks after it, meaning that I had to sit at my desk at lunchtime for 2 weeks and write sentences. I'm not still bitter, clearly. Over time, though, I think I am still triggered by witnessing injustices. I have gained tools for responding in more helpful ways and even moving toward taking action. As an adult, and I think this is true for many of us, our faith is a driving factor in influencing how we respond to injustice and inequity. I am grateful for the United Methodist Church's commitment to social justice in many forms. From the beginning, Methodist founder John Wesley and the early Methodists expressed their opposition to societal ills such as slavery, smuggling, inhumane prison conditions, and child labor. The work continues today in our church. And though I do not always agree with the church's official positions and actively work to change them at times, I am compelled by Methodism's core call to social holiness. Social holiness meaning the conviction that we live our lives together with all of God's creation. That we walk with one another, that we walk with those who are poor and vulnerable and marginalized, with the commitment to making life better for our neighbors, for all God's beloved creation. Now, I may be biased, but I think that Hamline Church is exemplary as a faith community who acts against injustice. For years, we have been known for our commitment to justice and compassion here in St. Paul and even beyond. Our ministries of justice and compassion often start because someone, an individual in our church, sees a need and comes forward and says, I'd like to do something about this particular situation. And we, the church, say, yes, we care about that too. God cares about that. How can we help? In recent years, we have seen this happen with instances like sponsoring refugee families and mission trips to Puerto Rico, partnerships with Hamline Elementary School, and our Earth Keepers ministry. Just this week, Earth Keeper and Deacon the Reverend Susan Mullen hosted a conversation about our call to stand with Indigenous people and protect the environment in the face of the Line 3 oil pipeline in northern Minnesota. And last weekend, we partnered with Face to Face at our Worship Unbundled event, because just a little over a year ago, Steve Bloom, a lay leader in our church, came to me and said, I really feel passionate about helping homeless youth in our community, especially because so many of these youth identify as queer and are often estranged from their families. Steve himself, a high school social worker by training, helped to connect us with Face to Face and their Safe Zone program, which provides basic needs, food and medical and mental health support for youth in Ramsey County. We have now contributed thousands of dollars and carloads full of t-shirts and underwear for these youth. Now, these are just a couple of examples of the many ways that Hamline Church engages in social holiness ministry. And in all of these instances, there is a pattern that is the same. A need or injustice arises, and God compels the heart of someone to act for change on behalf of our neighbor. As it turns out, this pattern is not unique to us. In our scripture today, we hear a story about the five daughters of a man named Zelophehad. Now, I thought it was hard to fairly divide cake with my three daughters. Just imagine what it was like with five. Back in this time, ancient Israelite tradition gave the right of inheritance to sons only. Women were thus not able to inherit property. However, Zelophehad's daughters were not having this. When their father died, the daughters, whose names are all called out in the text, and thank you to Tommy for reading them so wonderfully, he gets a ticket right to confirmation for taking that on. But when their father died, the daughters challenged the cultural traditions and asked Moses and the other leaders for their father's property. When the women spoke to the leaders did not dismiss their appeal, but instead listened, and they took it to God. In the Hebrew Bible, it's interesting to note that almost always in the instances where God speaks, it is involving a matter of change of tradition, a change of tradition that leads to social change. God listened to the daughters and affirmed them, saying, what the daughters are saying is right. Because of this, the legal code was rewritten to give the inheritance to one's daughters if they had no sons. These five sisters took it upon themselves to act, to bring about a more just result, not only for themselves, but also setting in place a social change in inheritance laws that would impact women for generations to come. Biblically, we see this in other places. In the New Testament, for example, Jesus openly challenged laws and traditions that were exclusive by nature. He saw the image of God reflected in those whom society deemed unworthy and enthusiastically invited them into the kingdom of God. God will step in to break tradition in order to bring justice to those who, up until now, have been excluded or deemed unworthy. But the key thing to note is that God includes us in bringing about justice. The women stood up for what they believed to be right. They acted on their convictions. Likewise, Moses first listened and then acted. Today, on Mother's Day, I am keenly aware of trailblazing women who, like the five sisters, had to stand up in the face of long-held societal customs and traditions. Mother's Day was, in fact, started by a Methodist woman, Anna Reeves Jarvis, and her daughters. They organized women's clubs in the 1860s during the Civil War in order to help suffering mothers and children, because they believed that women could provide a powerful, unified voice to bring about peace and an end to war. Their legacy helped pave a path for countless others, and even just a few days ago, we celebrated the 65th anniversary of the ordination of women in the United Methodist Church. In my own life, for me, my mom was one of those trailblazers, a trailblazer for social change in the face of injustice. My mom was one of the first female lawyers in our small town growing up in southern Minnesota. Much of the underlying narrative of my life was watching my mom assert herself and find her way in what had been a predominantly male field, starting her own law firm, becoming a leader in various legal professional organizations, and watching firsthand how, though she herself had many experiences of sexism and marginalization over the years, how she was compelled to act in the face of injustices experienced by those on the margins. She was a constant advocate for women's health and reproductive rights. She initiated the community-wide conversation that would eventually bring about the mascot name change for Owatonna. And she often represented juveniles who found themselves very much alone in the justice system, helping them to get the help and support they needed to improve their lives. I am eternally grateful for this example in my life and hope that my daughters will find similar inspiration as I did from my mom and countless other women and men who stood for their convictions and acted to challenge injustice and bring about social change. As we saw in the story of the five sisters, God extended the table even wider to include those at the margin. And we are called to join in that work. We have a lot of traditions in our churches and in our communities and world. And there are many ways the traditions of the church have gotten it wrong over the years. And we know that we still have a long way to go. But thankfully, it is clear that God is still speaking among us. I give thanks that our church and our faith tradition have a long history of extending the table wider, of working to challenge injustice, to show compassion, and to ensure that there is cake for everyone. At Hamline Church, we will continue to ask, how is God calling us to widen our table to include people and voices that have been excluded? Who do we need to listen to now, and how are we being called to act for justice? My friends, that work starts with you, with each of us. I invite you to ask yourself, whose story, what injustice is on your heart that God is compelling you to act on right now? Again, this week, as we will do throughout this series, we close with a personal reflection as part of a video series highlighting the call for an inclusion and justice from diverse voices of Minnesota United Methodists. Today, we hear from the Reverend Don Hauser, the chairperson of the Committee on Native American Ministry in Minnesota and the pastor of Aiken United Methodist Church. Again, I invite you to deeply listen to her heart and her call, and in this moment, to reflect on how God might also be calling you, compelling you to work for greater inclusion and justice in the name of building the kingdom of God here and now. Thanks be to God. Amen.
My name's Dawn Hauser, and I am Anishinaabe. My people are of the Sioux Tribe of Chippewa in the UP of Michigan. I'm a mother and a wife and a grandmother, and I am actively involved in our community here in Aiken. I'm a school board member, and I'm also a United Methodist pastor, and I am appointed to Aiken United Methodist Church. Aiken United Methodist Church is located just 20 miles of Mille Lacs Lake, and Mille Lacs Lake is home of the Mille Lacs Band of Ojibwe. And so I'm very fortunate to be surrounded by many people who I consider to be my relatives. Fond du Lac Tribe is not very far away either. It's kind of sad living in, I call it Indian country, and realizing as a United Methodist pastor that we don't have a Native American church here in the state of Minnesota. At least the United Methodists don't. You know, that kind of leads me to thinking a little bit about what would that even look like? And so I think what that looks like for me is if there were a Native American church, Native people from all over the state of Minnesota, Native United Methodists, would have a place to gather where they could worship and praise and honor God in their own cultural context. And that's important to me. Inclusion of all peoples is important. As a Native American person, we recognize that all people are interrelated and interconnected with one another, just like we are interrelated and interconnected with all of creation. My hope is for the future of the United Methodist Church in Minnesota is that we would one day be a church that we could hold a mirror up to ourselves and see that it would be a mosaic of faces of all different ethnicities and colors and just be this beautiful mosaic. And that we could look to that mosaic and say, this is God. This is the beloved community of God. And all these people, regardless of where they come from, what ethnicity they were born into, that they would know that they belong to God and that they are a part of God and God's beloved community. God is calling me to some very different things. Obviously, God has called me to ministry, but God is also calling me to share about our Native American spirituality in an authentic way so that all people can come to understand and realize that our Native American spirituality, our way of life, is not heretical to Christianity. And God has called me into some really interesting things. Recently, I started to work with a couple of friends, and we have formed a nonprofit organization, Magiziwadaswan, which means eagle's nest. And it's a cultural retreat and learning center, and people of all ethnic backgrounds will be invited to come and retreat there and learn about Native American spirituality. I really hope and pray that as we move forward as United Methodists in Minnesota, that we can begin to reconcile with the history. There's a lot of history that has taken place here in Minnesota, especially surrounding Native peoples. And it is my hope that we could begin a process of moving toward reconciliation. Reconciliation is only the beginning of that process, but then the change comes after that. And so it is my hope and prayer that we would be moving toward reconciliation and that one day we would be that beautiful mosaic of people for God. Amen.
Sitting here wanting memories.
Thank you so much, Mini Choir. How wonderful it is to have folks gathering and making music together once again in Safeways, and we so look forward to expanding this to more folks and to having folks experiencing that here in person with us as well. As we come to the end of our service, I want to invite you to consider how it is that you are being called to act, how it is that God is compelling your heart to respond with love and meet the needs of our neighbors. There are many ways that we do this together at Hamline Church and in our own lives through acts of service and compassion, through helping out in a variety of ways. One of the ways that we do this is through the work of our financial giving, of sharing our resources to support the mission and ministry of Hamline Church in our community and beyond. So I invite you to give as you are able. And there are three ways to give. You can give online at hamlinechurch.org/give. You can send a contribution by mail, or you can give by text. Thank you for your ongoing support and generosity. Another way that you can act is to engage in any of the myriad of justice and compassion ministries we have going on. One I want to highlight for you this week is that on Saturday, May 22nd, we are going to be helping to build a playground for the residents of Emma's Place. Emma's Place is a transitional shelter for women and children that is connected to our ministry partner, Emma Norton Services. And out in Maplewood, we are going to help to put a new playground in place for the children who live there. If you would like to sign up, you can contact the church office. There's more information in our weekly email. You're welcome to come for just the morning or afternoon or the entire day, and lunch will be provided. So I hope you can be a part of that. Friends, as we go forth into this week, may you always remember that the beauty of God's world is all around us, as the choir sang. And may you be reminded that in instances where we do not see beauty, where injustice and oppression creeps in, that in these moments, God gives us everything we need to compel our hearts to act for justice, to help bring about a better world through acts of love and grace and mercy. Let us go forth to engage in this work with one another and in the name of Jesus our Christ. Go in peace to love and serve our God. Thanks be to God. Amen.